May I now take the honor of inviting Professor Sushant Dattagupta to share his words with us. Sir, please.
A very good morning, everybody. I'm extremely grateful to the chairman of the council, Mr. T.K. Sahu, principal, Sai International, and the school fraternity, all the students, all the teachers, all the staff members, for giving me this unique opportunity to be here on the 7th Foundation Day and asking me to share my thoughts on what education should be like. A brief glimpse at the school campus, which is, as you know, spread over about 8 acres of very prime land in Bhubaneswar, and also the website that was demonstrated just about a few minutes ago, clearly gives an impression that within a very short time, this school has developed into one of the leading institutions of emancipated learning and also a seat of quality educations. So today I'm going to share my experience with education. As was mentioned in the introduction, before coming to Vishwa Bharati, I was involved with making one other institute, and this is called the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research. And what I would try to do with you now is to share my experience of how to carry out this important task of building capacity. Mr. Sahu, principal, vice principal, all the teachers are very experienced in already, because this school has been in existence for close to 7-8 years, and it's not easy to build things in our country. Many of us are involved with academics, we teach, we carry out research. However, institution building needs other kinds of acumen. You have to acquire a piece of land, you have to have a consultant architect, you have to have construction activity, and simultaneously develop academic vision. You must have a vision, you must have a dream, like as is already clear the chairman has. And it is this dream that has to be imparted to all of you, because after all, an institution is not just built by one person. It has to be a collective effort. So institution building is a rare phenomenon in our country, because somehow we don't seem to have mastered that kind of an expertise or that kind of attribute which goes into the issue of institution building. So today I will discuss with you what it takes to do an institution building activity, and then eventually come to one of the greatest thinkers, one of the greatest philosophers, one of the greatest poets, and in fact, one of the greatest human beings that this country has produced, Rabindranath Tagore. Though he is known for his work on poetry, his book of Gitanjali, A Song of Rains, which was a citation for the first Nobel Prize in Asia in 1913, he was also a great institution builder. And I would like to share some of his ideas and some of his thoughts. As the chairman, Mr. Sahu, said, that he will like to imbibe some of Tagore's thoughts in this school here, and we would indeed be very, very pleased to work with him in fulfilling that goal. So once again, I thank Mr. Sahu and his other colleagues, and also very charming Mr. Deepak Somani, who comes from Bolpur, to have accompanied me to this campus from the airport. So the title of my presentation is Establishing Institutions, developing education and building capacity. So as I said, before coming here, I was the founder director, before coming to Vishwa Bharati, that is, which is about 2.5 years ago, I was the founder director of a new experiment that this country has undertaken, and that's called IISER, Indian Institutes of Science Education and Research. They got started in 2006 with two IISERs, one in Kolkata and one in Pune. I was involved from the very beginning while I was director of the S.N. Bose Center as a program coordinator of the vision of IISERs and also writing what is called a detailed project report for the planning commission, etc., etc. And eventually I was appointed the founder director of the Kolkata IISER. Today we are five. Kolkata, Pune, then in 2008 we got one more started in Mohali near Chandigarh, and then in that's in 2007 I beg your pardon, and in 2008 two more in Bhopal and Thiruvananthapuram, so we are five. Roughly speaking, I should also add that in addition to the five which are administered by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, there is one in Bhubaneswar, administered by the Department of Atomic Energy and incubated in the Institute of Physics in Shaheed Nagar, called NICER, National Institute of Science Education and Research. So one NICER and five IISERs, they have actually similar goals, and that goal is to have an alternative to the very successful IIT system, the Indian Institutes of Technology. As you know, the IIT system caters to technology, while IISERs are supposed to look after strengthening basic sciences. What we feel is that unless you strengthen the base of the pyramid, applications of science will not grow. So in IISERs, we try to attract young, fresh, bright students like you right after high school, that is class 12, and admit them through an integrated master's program. So there is no intervening BSc, or there is no honors or pass course, etc., etc. It's a five-year program where the first 2 years are devoted to all branches of basic sciences, namely mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, bit of earth sciences, computer applications, environmental sciences, and then only the third year you decide, in consultation with the counselor, which area you would like to specialize in. It could be biology, it could be mathematics. So that's your major subject, but you can also have minor subject in all these other areas. And then research methodology is incorporated from the very beginning. You do projects in India, abroad in the fourth year, and many other laboratories all over the country of Department of Atomic Energy or the Space Research or Council of Scientific Industrial Research, etc., etc. So now, like Sci International, it started from scratch. So how do you get started? So as the leader of an institute, you have to look at various things, which I'm sure was also the experience here. So I have a chart here. I don't know, you may not be able to read it from a distance, but I'll read it for you. Yeah, you can't read it, I think. So you have curriculum development, as I said, for integrated masters and PhD. You have to worry about student enrollment, because there are national institutes like Sci International is, could be international as well. You have to develop teaching laboratories, because one of the things that we have noticed is that though science is totally experimental, laboratories are not in good shape in many colleges, many schools. So we have to develop laboratories, we have to develop research laboratories, maybe not in schools, but definitely in a university. And you also have to have infrastructure in the construction. So we got started, incubated from the IIT Kharagpur campus in Calcutta. We quickly made a building. I'm going through it very quickly just to give you an idea of all that it takes to build an institution. And then we had rudimentary laboratories in the small rooms. In the beginning, we had only 40 students in the year 2006. But then soon we had to move to our own campus. So this is an area which is about 50 kilometers north of Calcutta near Kalyani. And you know, while our new campus was coming up, we found that there were really some old buildings. You can see completely ramshackle buildings here. But this is the lesson that you learn in India. You know, you have to make do with whatever you have, and you have to innovate. So you start innovating, really, you know, filthy, very old buildings, which were part of another university, which left these three buildings behind, and we quickly renovated them. And again, the pictures are not very clear, but this is how they look like today. So we have this APC Revise also. We had a canal side hut to have a discussion area. There's a beautiful water body around, very scenic. And then you have to develop quickly laboratories. Again, you may not be able to see the pictures, but very quickly I would like to say what we have got already in IISc, and more now because I have already left 2.5 years ago. All this data are kind of old by at least 3 years. So magnetic property measurement system, a pulse laser diffusion scheme, a magnetic optic curve effect. This is to say that all that you have to do, crystal extracrystallography, club boxes, powder diffraction, optical tweezers. So what are the various programs? Some of you may be interested. Get into it through nationally organized exam system and also something called the Kishore Vigyani Patsahani Yojana, KVPY program from the Department of Science and Technology, which I'm sure you may be familiar with, and also the INSPIRE program of the Department of Science and Technology. All students who get into IISc get INSPIRE fellowship and contingency research support. So we have post-MSc PhD program, we have post-PhD integrated PhD program, and post-BTEC MS thesis program, in addition to the most important program, which is the first one that I mentioned, is the 5-year master's program. Now, having served this university, undergraduate science university, which is called Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, and my earlier experience as director of the S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences, and also my experience in building up the School of Physical Sciences in Jawaharlal Nehru University. They are all science institutions. My area, as was mentioned, area of specialization in research is physics, in particular condensed matter physics, subject that deals with things like superconductivity, superfluidity, and also statistical physics. But now, for the last 2.5 years, I enter the portal of another great institution of learning, which is not just devoted to science, but is aspiring to make good human beings out of you, to give you a holistic, all-encompassing education, and that is Vishwabharati. Therefore, my young students, I want to present to you a Tagore who was not just a Nobel laureate, but an extraordinary institution builder, a visionary educationist, a man whose thoughts transcend international boundaries and time zones, and above all, a universalist who viewed education as a holistic, all-encompassing human endeavor, unifying arts and sciences. Tagore did not view arts, humanities and sciences to be different pursuits, but thought of all of them as a unifying concept in making better citizens out of you. So this lecture will highlight also Tagore's deep love for nature, his eternal fascination for the marvel of creation, some of which was already mentioned by Sri Sahu, and the energy his songs exude. Unfortunately, I don't have my Sangeet Bhavan colleagues here who were present in these lectures that Sahu mentioned that we presented in Delhi. So that gives another dimension when you also have Tagore's songs expressing his philosophy. Of course, in the beginning, in the invocation itself, in the choir of Sai, we had this beautiful Tagore songs of Klanti Amar Kama Karo Prabhu, and also in between you have a few lines of Chitta Jetha Vaishunno Uccha Jetha Shiv Gyan Jetha Mukta Jetha Griher Prachi, and in the end it says, in this land you, I seek my freedom, O my Lord. And then you also had Jodi Tor Dakshune Kyo Na Shri Tabe Akla Chalori. So his songs actually portray his deep philosophy about nature, about education itself. So Vishwabharati is also called Yatra Vishwam Bhavati Kanidam, where the world makes a home in a single nest. And so, you know, in all his songs, you will see that he has the idea of comprehensive education, including science stage teaching, which carry a message of vitality, vibration, what the poet called Torongo. This is what, you know, Mr. Sahu mentioned, that when he went to Vishwabharati, he felt a vibration in the air. So be it outdoor classes, which I'll talk to you about a little later, exploration of nature, rural reconstruction, or his passionate attraction to the deductive logic of science, the poet extols the power of vibration. Tagore's greatest creation, Vishwabharati, is an epitome of borderless education. And you know, this is therefore, in the name itself, as the chairman mentioned, Vishwabharati, Vishwa is the world, or more generally the universe, and hence the connotation to university. A university, according to Tagore, belongs not to Shantiniketan or Birbhum or West Bengal or India, but to the entire world. Here people, faculty and students should come from all over the world, stay in our campus, interact with us and carry out teaching and research. As was mentioned by the chairman, in 1928, Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore invited the Chinese scholar Tanian Xiang to come to Shantiniketan, and a few years later Vishwabharati had his China Bhavan started. There was Japanese scholars like Okakura come and visit Shantiniketan, and we still have Nippon Bhavan. Leonard Elmhurst, a noted agricultural scientist, was invited by Tagore in 1920 to start agricultural sciences. Then about social work, he had C.F. Andrews, who was also a follower of Mahatma Gandhi, also known as Dinobandhu Andrews, stay in Shantiniketan to work on social work. So you see, the idea was to open your doors, open your windows to the outside world. Let outside ideas come, mingle with your own ideas and create something which is unique. Tagore always believed in East-West unification through philosophy. He did not believe really in nationalism, on which he even had some conflicts with Mahatma Gandhi, because he thought that India would gain by interacting with the external world, and he wanted to have an inclusive system rather than an exclusive one. So as I said, and as was mentioned earlier, Tagore believed in our traditions deeply rooted in the Eastern civilization of India, Persia, China and Japan, but wanted assimilation of Western thoughts and ideas. Next is the word Bharati. As you all know, is a remarkable phrase with multiple meanings. Bharati is Saraswati, goddess of learning, yet Bharati connotes to Bharat, India. And Vishwabharati is therefore a seat of learning embedded in India, but open to the whole world. It's a place where East meets West to unravel the beauty and truth of the universe. A year before his death, and that is August 1941, Tagore appealed to Mahatma Gandhi through a letter dated 19 February 1940 to take a closer interest in Vishwabharati, as the latter, quote, is like a vessel carrying the cargo of my life's best treasure, and I hope it may claim special care from my countrymen for its preservation, unquote. Gandhi replied the same day, saying, quote, you may depend upon my doing all I can in the common endeavor to assure its permanence. Adding, Vishwabharati is a national institution, it is undoubtedly also international. Rising in the parliament in 1951, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, our first prime minister, said this, quote, we have looked upon Vishwabharati not only as a very great institution, but as a very special and unique institution, and we are particularly anxious that it should not fall into the rut of other universities. So let me give you a few dates. Vishwabharati, as was mentioned again by Mrs. Sahu, got started as a Brahmacharya school, which then later became Patabhavan, in 1901, but was called a university or Vishwabharati in 1921, which was registered a public body and got adopted a constitution of its own. But then it was declared as a central university after independence, an institution of national importance, in May 1951 by an act of parliament. It is indeed the first central university in the whole country. Even the University Grants Commission, the UGC, got started 2 years later in 1953. Tagore's approach to education is remarkable. Like here, education begins in primary school, and like the roots of a tree, grows into flourishing branches and leaves that constitute the university. Thus, Patabhavan and Shikha Shatra were born as the base of Vishwabharati, from where students evolved directly to the university level, an astonishing idea indeed. Many prominent scholars of Vishwabharati, including vice-chancellors such as late Oshin Das Gupta, had taught in Patabhavan. Many illustrious sons of the world, such as Amartya Sen, Bhakta Das Gupta and others, had studied there. Studying in Patabhavan also meant being close to nature. Thus, through classes held outside, underneath trees, students were exposed to an environment that naturally arouses curiosity about nature, seasonal changes, orientation of the sun and the moon, photosynthesis, animal behavior, weather patterns, ecology. What better way can there be than an understanding of science in its most rudimentary form? You don't need big laboratories to teach basic sciences. For instance, there is fantastic social behavior of insect colonies like ants, bees, and this is an area called entomology. And you don't need laboratories to do that. You can, your ground outside is a laboratory where you can study, you can give projects to the students to study basic entomology. Here's a picture of what is called Kutibari. This is located in Sriniketan, about 5.5 kilometers from Shantiniketan. Because Tagore felt that just as Patabhavan was thought to be a fully residential school, where young children get up in the morning, go to Poitali, which are like assemblies, eat their breakfast together, do their prayers together, have a camaraderie, have a fellow feeling, and then there are classes outside where there is music, there is art, there is other form of cultures, and then go into higher learning. He felt that in the villages next to Shantiniketan, in Sriniketan area, in adjoining Surul, there were other people, rural people. There are tribals in Birbhum district. Now these children have their basic skills in pottery, weaving, leather making, and so he felt that these skills must be harnessed so that the children of that those areas must also have employment opportunities and build up their career. This is what we are calling now vocational training, community college ideas, etc. So in that regard, he bought this house, Kutibari, in 1912, mind you, 9 years before Vishwabharati was established in 1921, formally. So the students from Shantiniketan could go and work in villages surrounding Shurul for rural reconstruction. Today, this building forms the nucleus of Sriniketan in general and Shiksha Shatra in particular for providing hands-on training to rural students weaving, textiles, even electrical services come maintenance, and more recently we have introduced rural biotechnology. Shiksha Shatra is a further exemplification of Tagore's concern for the neighboring villages. He felt the university must reach out the surrounding habitats and propagate the message of vocational education, as I mentioned, thus inter alia expanding the scope for employability of rural children. Tagore believed that education is a vehicle for emancipation of mind, and this process could not be confined to just blackboard teaching of arts and science subjects. Thus, every student had an exposure to cultural aspects of life involving music, painting, sculptures, etc. And here is why we may call Vishwabharati a real university, a place where it is possible for an undergraduate student to take, for instance, courses in linguistics, computer science, music, painting, and even my own subject, theoretical physics. I'm sure Sai International School would also like to be a real school where you have all these interdisciplinary areas possible. Tagore was deeply, deeply influenced by Mustafa Jalaluddin Rumi, who was born in Kabul but lived in Shiraz of Persia, presently Iran, about 800 years ago. Many of you may not know that Tagore and his brother and his father, Maharshi Devendranath Tagore, were deeply influenced by Hafiz, the Sufi poet, and Rumi, of course, is the founder of Sufi philosophy, and that attracted Tagore, who made 2 visits to Iran. I suspect his deep interest in Bauls of Birbhum and introduction of Baul Shungit and Kirtan as a part and parcel of Ghosh Mela had emanated from Rumi's idea of Sufism. Today, no student is expected to come out of Vishwabharati without an appreciation of Baul and Kirtan Shungit. My dear students, though the pictures are not very clear, I hope you can see here Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore in animated discussion with one of the greatest physicists that the world has seen, that is Albert Einstein. Tagore made 2 visits to Berlin in 1930 and had deep discussions with Einstein, not just on music, Eastern music and Western music, but also on quantum mechanics, the quantum theory which was evolving through the 1920s. As you class 12 students may know, that you need quantum mechanics to understand the basic structure of atom molecules which go into your chemistry, your idea of bonding. And so quantum mechanics got started around 1925 with the Schrodinger equation, 1926 the Heisenberg uncertainty principle and quantum theory, and then Dirac equation in 1930, and Tagore was very much following that literature. Many of you may not have read Tagore's Vishwaparichoy because that is in Bengali, and we are in the process of translating it into various languages including English. And his conversation with great physicist Albert Einstein. You will be then aware of his deep interest in science. In particular, when Einstein was a reluctant believer in quantum theory, Tagore had astonishingly and without any formal training in science raised issues of observables, wave particle duality, etc. Thus Tagore viewed science not as a subject disjoint from liberal arts and music, but in fact a complementary pursuit of knowledge. In the discussion with Einstein, Tagore leans on Upanishada, which lays stress on aham, the self, and its interaction with the creator. He asks Einstein, quote, "Mr. Einstein, how do I know that the moon is beautiful? Yesterday was the Bengali day of the new year, Navavarsha, was also Purnima, and the day before was Vishu Sankranti in Orissa, and so you could see the full moon yesterday and day before." And so Einstein was asked this question by Tagore, "How do you know that the moon is beautiful unless I observe it?" It is this role of the observer which is very important in quantum theory. Normally in classical theories, you don't worry about the apparatus with which you are making the measurement. But in quantum mechanics, you have to bring the dynamics of what is being observed and what you are observing with into a full theory. And that's what he was asking Einstein about. It is this constant linkage between the self and that and nature that characterizes the marvel of creation. There are some beautiful songs of Tagore which epitomize this dynamics, this synergy between self and the nature. Tagore extends the notion of importance of the self and its interaction with the creator to even less evolved creatures, like the lightning bug. He has this beautiful poem and song called a lightning bug called Junaki Kishokeoi Tanaduti Merecho. He talks about vibration and energy dormant in every being in nature, large or small. So I'll just end by reading a few lines of this book in Vishwaparichay, which I mentioned are written in Bengali, these lines, but I will just try to make some English translation for your benefit. In the context, and this ideas of poet's thoughts on science and scientific concepts become also important in the context of the recent discovery of the Higgs particle, Higgs boson, sometimes in the newspapers called the God particle. Now these ideas, as I said, find form in Vishwaparichay, which Tagore wrote about 4 to 5 years before he passed away. At the twilight of Gurudev's life, several notions and scientific discoveries had triggered his mind. So we want to offer a few glimpses of that in my limited English translation of what characteristically very lucid Bengali prose. In the preface to Vishwaparichay, the poet writes affectionately to his young colleague Satyendranath Bose, who also eventually was a vice chancellor of Vishwabharati. And here I quote Tagore, and please listen to these lines which are so important, so significant. "Any educated person must enter the arena of science, if not the core of science, and in this regard it is no shame to take the help of literature. I am not a serious student of science, but I had this endless temptation for tasting the juice of science from my very childhood." Then he goes on to write, "I was then about 12. When I had gone with my revered father to the Dalhousie Hills. After the day's hard work, we would settle on a divan in the veranda of our balcony. The sun provides a curtain of light around our earth, and therefore we are unable to visualize the universe beyond during the day. However, the day ends, the sun sets, the lid of light disappears, and it is then innumerable stars lit up the dark sky. Akash Kureshuni I could realize that the boundary of the universe extends far beyond our earth, gradually and beyond the periphery of mountain peaks. Underneath the blue clear sky descend the stars. Father would introduce me to them, to the planets, not merely an introduction, but he would also tell me the distance of their orbits from the sun, the time period of revolution. Akash bhara surya tara bishwa bhara pran tahari maj khane ami pechi murthai bishoye অসীম কালে যে হিল দোলে জোয়ার ফাটায় ভুবন দোলে নাড়িতে মোর রক্ত দ্বারায় লেগেছে তার টান বিস্ময়ে Among the stars in the middle of the night sky, one fine patches of light clustered around called the Milky Way. Powerful telescopes have revealed, this is what Tagore is writing in Vishwa Parichaya between 1934 and 1937, mind you, Powerful telescopes have revealed that the Milky Way comprises billions of stars. There is really nothing called darkness. Those which are invisible also possess light, like the dark universe that you hear about today. There is incessant emanation of radiation of different colors, even from the dark ends of the universe. Though a far distance away, stars, pulsars, quasars make their presence felt through light, some visible, some however invisible to the naked eye. Question then arose, what is the mode of travel of light? The answer is a fascinating story, Tagore writes. The light travels as waves. It is difficult to fathom the nature of these waves. Concomitantly, however, another piece of data, and he is referring to the photoelectric effect for which Einstein got the Nobel Prize in 1905, which brought out a contrasting picture of light, that light consists of innumerable corpuscles or tiny particles. Experiments reveal, Tagore is writing, that these light corpuscles are like a shower of very minute objects, which in today's parlor are called bosons, after the name of their discoverer, Satyendranath Bose, another great scientist of India. Waves and particles, how does one reconcile these two apparently contradictory picturization of light, Tagore asks. What is more mind-boggling is that while the external manifestation of light is either as a wave or a particle, what appears in the micro world is neither this nor that. We call it radiation, and this is indeed the superposition principle of quantum theory that Tagore had an intuitive understanding of, though not a formal training in. One of the most bewildering entities of modern science, Tagore writes, is a little hidden universe within our grand universe, and here he's talking about the atomic world. You have the universe, the solar system, and the sun is at the focus, and then you have the planets moving around, and then you transcribe that and go inside an atom. The scales are relatively the same. Inside the atom, at the center, at the core, you have the nucleus, and then you have the electrons moving around. The relative distances, the sizes of the nuclei and the, like the protons and the neutrons which comprise the nucleus and the electrons and their distances are similar to the sun, its size, and the planets moving around. So this is the atomic world, and this tiny world is invisible to us, but is at the very root of all creation. All your genes, all your cells in the body are made of molecules and atoms. Tagore further writes, physicists now have found ways of breaking open the seemingly impregnable doors of atoms to reveal subatoms, namely electrons and protons. And Tagore is writing in 1934, let me now give the example of the lightest of atoms, namely hydrogen. At the center of the hydrogen atom resides an electrically charged particle called proton that you all know of. And in the orbit of the proton revolves a single electron. The negative electron is itinerant, while the positive proton is heavy and static. Recently, scientists have discovered the antiparticle of electron, which is called the positron, which is the same mass of electron, but is positively charged. This is remarkable because positron was discovered in 1932, and Tagore was writing the book in 1934, but he was aware of his discovery being made in the world of physics. I'll just end my lecture by just one more paragraph, which tells you how Tagore was also aware of the accelerators which we use today in Geneva in the Large Hadron Collider to go inside the atomic structure. What education should be all about. And Rabindranath Tagore epitomizes that model of education. That's a remarkable model where education begins at the very roots, like the roots of a tree, and just as it gets nourishment through the water to the soil, then education grows to the roots of the tree and flourishes into the branches and the tree leaves that then undergo photosynthesis because of absorption of sunlight, and that's what research is all about. And it is this confluence of all-encompassing education which is what Tagore model was all about, and I'll be very pleased to work with Sai International to impart or to improve our own self and also the school here to mutually benefit and make it an inclusive experience. I would like to thank you once again for inviting me here. Namaskar.